You're going to get what you deserve. Bow down before the one you serve. You're going to get what you deserve.
Alright, welcome back to edition 81 of the Bebo Knows podcast. This is your host, Brian Bullock, and with me today I have returning guest, Alan Boston on the pod. How you doing tonight, Alan?
Well, somewhere in the middle. Maybe a fever coming down, but we'll do the best we can.
Alright, well, appreciate you having you on despite the lack of health there. I figured we'd revisit some of the things that we discussed on the last pod. I know when we had you on the pod, it's the first pod I had you on since you moved away from Vegas, and I kind of wanted to get your thoughts on your year, at least your basketball season away from Vegas, and how, you know, it might have impacted your betting, if at all, and, you know, maybe it's made you change your approach or your thoughts on betting in general. You know, I don't know if you could get into that a little bit.
I think in reflecting upon what's gone wrong this year is, number one, the game's changed. This 30-second clock has really made favorites a little more attractive, and any old-school handicapper is kind of conditioned towards betting underdogs. That's been a problem. Number two, for years I had a very healthy routine going in Vegas. I don't have the same routine. I'm on a different time zone, and I need to go to bed much earlier here, but it's been difficult getting my go to bed at the same time, get up at the same time, go to the gym every day. It hasn't been happening here. Part of it is finances, and part of it is just I'm in a different world. The good news is I love where I'm living. The bad news is it's not college basketball betting is probably something that I should consider not doing again. It's they book way too many teams, and it's just way too much work. I do so much work, I have no time to think about the game. And that was always my strength, was kind of stuff would kind of hit me, and I'd see the right logic for a game, and I'd be able to make big bets on that, and the number didn't matter that much. I wanted a fair price for whatever my thought was, but I don't have that anymore. I don't have time to reflect, so there's no foundation. There's so many teams, I don't remember them all anymore, and, you know, I put all my eggs in one basket in a house and ended up getting next to nothing for it, and that made the finances a lot trickier, and it made winning a lot more important. And when winning becomes that important, it subconsciously adds a lot of stress. And my betting amounts have been inappropriate. I used to bet so big that a small bet that isn't really that small a bet wouldn't affect me because the big bets were so much bigger, but the smaller bets I make now are actually getting in the way of all the good I do. So there's a myriad of reasons why things are not going great. We're winning small going for the year coming into this week, and it's just, I need more help, and it's not a loner kind of thing. I have a little bit of help, but not enough. And I'm not as good as I once was, probably. You know, I've been doing it for almost 30 years, and at one time, when I first started, it was all very exciting to me, and I really didn't give a fuck if I won or lost. Who cares if I was broke? It was kind of like fun, trying to through each day with no money. But then when I had money, it was a lot more fun having it than not. I promise you.
Sure.
Those who say money doesn't buy happiness never had money before. So anyway, so that kind of carefree attitude. And an easier game to beat just allowed for a lot better flow. And then I think about it day and night. If I lost a game, I'd think about why I lost it and try to, you know, take note that that didn't work or, you know, whatever. And it was a constant learning experience. But now I'm trying to change 20 years of how I've done it. And then 5 years of how I've done it. And it's changing again. And it's just, the line's much tougher. There's people who go out early in these games and just bet the right way. It's really a very, very difficult sport to beat. And, you know, I don't think I'll endeavor to do this again. It's just not worth the time. I can find something better to do with my life. Even if it's working at a McDonald's, it's better than just suffering through basketball where, you know, you lead for 58 minutes and 59 minutes and 39 minutes. I mean, you know, whatever the time is,
you get
the message. You lead the whole game in the last 30 seconds. You know, they hit threes when you're the favorite, and they never miss a foul shot when you have the underdog. And it's just, I'm just sick of it. Yeah, it's just been that way for a while, and I've had it. I'm not sure I can win. That's the other thing. You know, it's a hard thing to come to grips with because I at one time probably was better than everybody at this, and I'm not bragging. I'm really just reality. I mean, I hit an astronomically high number of winners on when I really like something, the game almost always won. And even with my degeneracy, I was able to overcome it and earn a really good living. I mean, I'm not complaining. I've been my own boss my whole life, and, you know, I've done it with integrity and what more can you do, really? So in that way, I'm proud. The thing that's been disappointing is my tweets have been absolutely terrible. And last time I tweeted, I went 0-3, and I didn't sleep all night. I felt so bad about it that it's just like, I can't do this. It's just not fair to them. It's not fair to me. And, you know, I might have actually won that night, too. That was so frustrating. But I can't tell them I laid 2 when the game's 4. You know, you just lose those. You lose all that. So anyway, that's what's wrong. What's right is it's still in there for me to win. I still occasionally have moments where, oh, yeah, I remember who I was. But when you're up against it, you need good things to happen, especially when you're so hard on yourself like I am. You need good things to happen more often than not, and that has not been the case. My bell curve has been once again to the left, and I need it center or right probably at this point in my life. So
okay.
Anyway, I still know the game. I still can talk about the game. So
all right, well, I'm done
bitching. But that's a sad reality. I'm not complaining. I'm just giving you the facts that it's just, you know, I think second halves, maybe there's some merit to betting them. If people have programs for totals, they're probably very beatable because they put up totals in every single game. I can't imagine them, you know, not having some errors there. And, you know, if you have someone who can do a lot of reading, there's probably stuff you can take from the reading to win a first half better or total or something. There's better ways to do it than just trying to beat the straight bets. And unfortunately, you know, that's what I've done my whole life, and I'm not changing. Not in my late 50s. It's just not going to happen. So I was hoping that with the gambling becoming more okay to talk about, where, you know, it's really even overdone at times on some of these stations, that there'd be a place for me. But I don't think I'm hireable. I think that, you know, bashing ESPN is not the way to get on ESPN, and speaking the truth about how corrupt the whole sport is probably not what they want to hear. But, you know, that's the truth, and that's what I'm always going to say. So, unfortunately, you know, the odds came out about 15 years too early. Had the odds come out now, I'd probably be a rock star and wouldn't have to worry the rest of my life. But that's not what happened. So I'll figure out what's next after the season's over. I am going to finish the year out. I am going to beat it. But
okay. Yeah, because I know at this time last year, I would say that you were having doubts about even doing this year, but then you had that project you were going to be doing. So
yeah, but that really hasn't really had I think he had hoped to do a project, but I also think he wanted to talk to me on a daily basis. So I think there was part of that. I think he was telling the truth. He seems like a really nice guy, and we have stayed in touch. But
okay,
that's something I could do. I could write about games and just say, you know, here's my thoughts on the games, and they'd be good thoughts. And, you know, maybe someone could take those thoughts and do something better with it than I could. Or maybe writing out the thoughts would point me in the direction of who's going to win. That's what I used to do when I had a schedule, is I would – we'd start betting in the morning and then, you know, pick off what we thought was right or even set up some games, to be honest with you. And then, you know, we had a bet before Mr. Walters bet, because once he bet, the numbers were done. But, you know, usually in the middle of the day when no one was doing anything, we'd go and make all our bets. But I had already had all morning to think about it. I'd go to breakfast and think about the games that I was considering. And if you – have someone to talk to, like I did. We, you know, I had a partner. We worked 24/7 on it. You know, I could just mull it over with him, and if it sounded good, it was good. If it didn't sound good, it was probably horseshit and probably not worth betting or not betting as much. So, you know, we even delineated what was good from what was bad on a daily basis. And I'm not doing that anymore, just because they book so many more games, and it's just so much more work. And I'm not even reading previews anymore. I used to get up and read every preview in every paper. I don't even do that anymore. And it's still, the work's still overwhelming. It's like, there's a better way to do it, and I don't know what that is. So, you know, it's time to do something else.
Okay. Now, speaking of change, one of the things that I wanted to talk about, and I know we glanced upon it in our preview pod back in November, was some of the rule changes, specifically the shot clock. And you kind of referenced this in your beginning, where you were talking about how it seems to benefit the favorites. Now, as far as the game itself, did you think it would impact it as much as it has?
I think what impacted it even more than the 30-second clock, which I didn't think would have that much effect. I underestimated its effect, because I forgot how many more possessions there are, and when there's more possessions, there's more rebounds for the bigger, stronger team to get. And the more rebounds you get, you know, the team defends well for 30 seconds now, and they miss, but they get the rebound, and they run the clock again, and they miss again, but they get the rebound again and put it in, and now you've defended for a minute, yet they've scored. It just eventually breaks your back. And, you know, you see these rebounding stats that are just staggering in one way. The other rule change where they're calling fouls at a lot more rapid rate and almost seemingly randomly. People even know what a foul is anymore, because what is a foul in one game is not a foul in another game. But it gives controls to the referees, and that's just not a good thing either. It just, like I said, you know, I to me, the sport is entirely corrupted, and there's really – I wouldn't put anything past any of them. And if you watch closely, you'll see which teams are on the bubble and see if they get more calls than the teams they're playing in some of these late-season games. You know, maybe Colorado's on the bubble in the Pac-12 or UCLA. I'm not sure who it is. I don't follow that stuff. But you will see that if there's a call that has to go their way, they'll probably get it, because it means too much for the – conference to get that school in, and everyone knows it. That's how bad I think it is. But
okay,
with all the whistle stoppages, it has created a game where it has become guards trying to break the other guards down one-on-one. Again, it favors the more athletic guards who are capable of doing that. And when you jam the middle like a lot of the teams have done, and kind of pack it in, it leaves three-pointers wide open, or it leaves drives and dishes when you come to help, try to stop the guy from penetrating or getting fouled. It leaves someone open for a wide-open three. So it's become a three-point shooting contest and an athletic guard contest. And like Houston shot like 72% in the second half last night. They hit like an inordinate number of threes. You just see all these games where these teams just hit, just bomb threes in at a crazy rate. And again, that's kind of random. Sometimes the threes are good shots, and sometimes than not. So I can't mathematically. How am I going to say this so it sounds makes sense? I'll allow for the fact that sometimes teams just have bad shooting nights and sometimes teams have good shooting nights. But it seems that with the combination of how of the 30-second clock and how they want this game played, that three-point shooting has determined a lot more games than I thought it would. You'll see a lot of teams keep players in foul troubles. And if that happens, you're screwed. There's a lot of randomness that you can't control that affects the games greatly. And so the rule changes have done what the NCAA wants. It's taken away a lot of intelligent basketball and made it more of an athletic contest, more of an NBA-type game, which is sad because it's supposed to be college basketball. It's not supposed to be an NBA minor league. There's no money in an NBA minor league, and there's plenty of money in college basketball, and that's why there is no NBA minor league. It doesn't mean that they should have went and completely corrupted what was once such a beautiful game, but that's what they've done. And that kind of bugs me too, because I did this as a fan first and learned to win as a fan. So to see a game I really once loved and lived for go in the shitter, it's kind of subconsciously turns me off too. And you know, a lot of the fervor, a lot of the pizzazz I have for doing this is all done too. So there's a lot of things working against me. A lot of them, you know, I'm just copping out and being a little fucking baby about it. But a lot of them are legit, and I'm 57 years old now. I'm not 30. I'm not in as good a shape as I once in. I don't work out as hard as I did. I don't eat as well as I once did. And all that's just, you know, you put all your eggs into your house, and your house goes from being worth $3 million where you're going to retire to being worth $1 million where you barely get anything out of it. And, you know, now you're back to square one at the age of 57. It's just not... it's not a pleasant atmosphere to try to win in, and the game got tougher and I got worse. So, and the rule changes did not help. That's the essay that I was trying to get at. Anyway, so yeah, that's what I think.
So, has there ever been in your time betting? Has there been a rule change that you, maybe when you were stronger at betting, where you were ahead of everything else, where you were ahead of the bookmakers, where you like kind of caught what was going to happen before the odds makers did?
No. I've always been a logic type guy. I taught myself how to do it by watching a ticker all night. So how the game played out was most important to me. And my mind worked well in like picking out what was relevant about how the game played out. So, you know, obviously a team that gets ahead 32-2 and wins by 10 is more impressive than a game that's tied the whole way and ends on 10. It's the same final, but obviously the 32-2 team, you know, was clearly 50 points better. That's an obvious way to show how a game playing out matters. But there were all these little runs that teams would make during games that I would remember and thought that they, if they could carry that out in a certain situation, that they'd be able to win some game. And I was able to do that rather successfully, but that's when there were, 100 to 150 teams, not 300 teams. And so, you know, my approach of how a game plays out is not as relevant anymore. It's the rules and the shortened shot clock and the propensity of the 3-point shot has made the swings a lot more dramatic. So I still try to use that, but it's just not as relevant as it once was, and I'm not following every game like I once did, where I knew every update. I just can't do it. I'm not capable of doing it. It's, you know, again, you know, I can keep track of 100 teams on a Saturday, but I can't keep track of 300 teams on a Saturday.
Right.
So I don't even bother sweating scores every minute now. It's too painful anyway. And you know, 20-point leads in the old days were golden. 20-point leads now are shit. So there's that problem. There's the problem of I've talked about on a prior podcast where psychology was very important to me, where I was ahead of the field with, you know, like the old school basketball games where they hire local referees half the time, you know, and the home team would get every call. And before everything was on national TV, you know, there were key games for teams all over the country. And some may not even be as obvious. So typically, it would typically more be like a home team that was waiting for someone to come, and a home underdog even more typically. And the road team, not used to being thrown to the wolves, you know, coming to this complete madhouse where the fans are on top of the court, would rattle a little bit. And the unrelenting energy of the home team, where they were just so motivated and focused for this game, would carry through the whole game. Now with a 30-second clock and extra possessions, the motivated home dog sometimes runs out of gas a little bit sooner than they once did. And, you know, your plus six where you're leading the whole way gets away from you. Yeah, you could bet first halves and stop all that. But, you know, you get – that might be one way of countering that. I don't know. I've never charted all that and figured all that. But I'm just throwing out one example of where my methods have become a little antiquated. So this team goes into this madhouse and this team's waiting for them, but now they're used to it. You know, they've played on national TV a myriad of times. They've gone to these jungles a bunch of times. They play basketball 365 days a year. It's not, you know, a kid lettering in three sports anymore. It's a kid picking a sport and the parents usually, you know, hammering it in their heads and, you know, practice. And that's it. There's nothing that faces these kids anymore. They've made travel a lot easier for a lot of the teams. And, you know, it's a big money thing. You gotta keep the help happy.
Sure.
Yeah, it's a battle for me, and a lot of what I was good at doesn't work anymore. So it's there's moments where I feel smart, but they're fleeting.
It's, well,
don't make me such a bummer.
No, that's all right.
I've always battled rule changes because just you know, I was used to I trained myself doing it under one set of rules. It was even a 45-second clock back then that I had. And it was just the start of the three-point shot. So okay. I've always had that. The shortening of the shot clock has never been good for me because I've always liked coaches that control tempo and, you know, try to shorten the game and don't give away anything. And you might be able to pull an upset off here and there. I had a lot of games that was almost automatic where I had the superior coach in some neutral court setting at a preseason tournament or a pre-conference tournament, and you know, I'd be plus seven, and I knew that he'd shorten the game, so seven was like 4.5, and with the one game only thing where they're not in the same conference where they don't see each other too often, again the superior coach would have his team more prepared for the game and just won a lot of bets that way that I don't win anymore. So anyway,
okay. One thing on the rule changes.
That makes some sense.
No, that one thing with rule changes before we move on to more of the March Madness and conference tourney talk. If you were the head of the NCAA, what changes would you look to make immediately? Maybe in the next year, maybe down the line in the next 5 to 10 years.
Oh, I mean, I'm a basketball fan, so I want to see basketball played. I don't want to see a dunking contest. I mean, I would extend the shot clock. I don't like the 30-second shot clock. It's college basketball. It's not it's supposed to be, it theoretically, and you know, I'm not an idiot, so I know this is not the reality, but theoretically, and when I did go to college, this is what it was kids would go to college and they got to play a sport they loved. Now the sport they loved is a huge business. So, you know, the coaches are more CEOs than coaches are more often than not. And I'd get back to understanding that even if it is a big business, we should stop being so fucking hypocritical. And if we want to call them student athletes, let them be student athletes. I mean, even the fucking Ivy League wants to do a conference tournament. Can you imagine the last vestige of hope? They play Friday, Saturday games to minimize lost class time. You know, they do everything they can to make basketball secondary to an education, which is what it's supposed to be. So I'd raise the shot clock to 40 seconds anyway. I would allow kids to go right from high school to the pros because this one and done is just a crock of shit. Again, it has nothing to do with these kids going to college. Because, you know, Calipari's there, you know, just come here for a year and I'll get you a nice pro contract, which he will. Because his buddy's an agent who puts up the money to get the kid to go there. And then Calipari pushes him out to that agent and, you know, everyone's happy.
Yeah, it works.
Calipari wins and the agent gets a, you know, a player that he's going to get 10% of $100 million from or whatever it is.
Yeah, it works out well for everybody but the player.
Now the player, it might work out well for him too.
I guess it could, but I mean, if he's
not looking for college education, he's looking to play pro basketball. Right. So if you have kids looking to play pro basketball, let them go play pro basketball, you know, or do it like baseball does. Don't you have to play like you can go pro right out of high school or you have to play 3 years of college.
Yeah, I think it's something like that. Yeah.
I don't know what the penalty is if they don't play 3 years, but I don't think they can sign a pro deal. I think unless they play 3 years, so
yeah,
something like that would be more in line with what college sports should be like. But obviously, you know, when there's a B in front of the TV contract, you know, everything gets thrown by the wayside. That's why the committee is so corrupt. That's why the whole sport's so corrupt, because of the money. And the money's got to get to the right places, all the good old boys. And it's nothing different than our politicians making sure that their people get taken care of. You know, it's really an evil world. And in that regard, I'm glad I'm getting old.
All right, we'll stop talking about the rule changes here. We'll talk as far as the March Madness and conference tourney time. It's coming up pretty shortly, so as the tourney approaches, whether it be a team that's entering at the latter stages of the regular season or starting their conference tourney, do you adjust your approach to betting from the normal regular season? Like, does that do you take other things into consideration when you're betting at this time of year?
This used to be the absolute best time of year to bet because before it became a big business, when kids were normal college kids and not robots who were programmed to play, you know, 5,000%, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. I watched the show Friday Night Tykes last night. It might be the sickest television show ever on the air. They're handing it off to some 12-year-old kid like 50 times, and he's playing defense. The kid's been like knocked out like 4 times. He's 12 years old. And one coach is there, yeah, we're going to take him out immediately. And the other coach, when he's lying on the ground half dead, says, oh, you're all right, you can go in and play again. He's 12 fucking years old. This is, you know, Friday Night Lights, except Friday Night Tykes. So it's every bit as brutal as that Friday Night Lights book was. This Friday Night Tykes is even more brutal because they're dealing with fucking kids. Anyway, I don't know how I got off on that tangent. So back in the day, before the lunacy started, a team would go on the road with their seeding locked in for their conference tournament. And they'd go on the road to play this meaningless game. And for years, I just bet the home team. I mean, why the fuck would they ever want to give any effort at all? Their conference tournament's coming up in a week or 4 days or 5 days. This game doesn't matter if they win by 50, lose by 50. They're playing the same team at the same time in the conference tournament. Why would you want to even risk an injury or show anything that you may have in store for their conference tournament? Maybe you got some new set plays you want to, you know, surprise people with.
Sure.
And it used to be completely stealing. These lame duck games were gold. I just made a cup of coffee. People talked about senior night and what a good bet it was on senior night, but it wasn't senior night that worked. It was the apathy of the road team that worked. It wasn't the getting motivated for senior night that worked, because senior night can go the other way. It can be a very depressing, you know, the end is near, this is my last basketball game, that sucks kind of thing, where kids are bawling their eyes out, you know, during the game. It doesn't always work where they're all rah-rah, let's, you know, win our last home game. I remember Vermont was down like 25 to Maryland, Baltimore County, when they had that really good team with Tom Brennan's last year. It was like, it was just too much for them. The moment they were playing the last place team, they were down 25. They came back and won the game. But then when they played the conference tournament finale on their home floor, they were playing Northeastern. And I remember thinking to myself, wow, they've already had all this emotion of playing senior night. They've already gotten rid of all that. Now this will be the game where they really, you know, amp it up, because they've gotten the misery of their last game as a senior over with. This is like senior night without the negative emotion. And, yeah, they were playing to get into the tournament, so Northeastern's going to come with the home run effort. But in sports, when you have a focused favorite, which is difficult. It doesn't happen too often, or it used to not happen too often. I'll get back to that in a second. But anyway, I just pictured Vermont just like really just playing like to their absolute max and maybe even better. Like it just was going to be their home run game, and I bet an absolute fortune on that game. I laid like three different numbers, something I normally don't do. And it was an absolute wipeout. I mean, I had it right. And those were the kind of thoughts that would hit me, and I just go with it. I wouldn't even question myself. Now, you know, I question everything. So now, about 6-7 years ago, I'll never forget the game. I think it was Indiana State playing Drake. They were playing each other in the first round of the Missouri Valley Conference. They were also playing on the Monday before the Thursday of the Missouri Valley Conference tournament. Indiana State was at Drake. They were playing them on Thursday. I think Drake was the three-point favorite, and I'm saying, all right, well, Drake's going to kill him. I mean, what does Indiana State give two fucks about this game for? This is a game that they absolutely should mail it in. There's absolutely no reason to put effort out here. You're playing the same team 3 days from now. Go ahead. Just give them the game. Don't worry about it. Nope. Not even close to what happened. It was like three overtimes later. They finally finished the game. It was the stupidest, dumbest thing I ever could have seen in my life. They played three overtimes, and now they had to play on Thursday again. By the way, they were going to play four games in 4 days to get through the tournament. You know, But that's what the game's become. The coach may have had to win the game to keep his job. The kids are like robots. They're programmed that they have to play their asses off every minute of every day. It's no longer a college kid getting an education and playing a game he loves. It's a kid who must go all out on a basketball court, and he happens to be going to college. And so all these end-of-the-year situations that used to work, there might be one or two left that might work still, but even they're not that good. So when it comes to conference tournament time, yes, it's a new season. There's a new lease on life for many teams. So you definitely – it's more of a feel approach, like – you know, if a team's already in versus a team that's not in, you'd certainly expect the team not in to have some sort of an advantage. But they usually put that in the price. So, you know, sure. is it worth it anyway? And it's just kind of it's really just feel, and watching how a game plays out. And I hope you're still there, because
No, I'm here.
Yeah, I have a touch screen thing here and it moved you.
Oh, you're.
So I actually have like a bunch of rules that I've written out for conference tournament week, and
Yeah, read them off.
Some worked over the years, some haven't, and it's you know, some of it's kind of obvious. I've always thought that, and it's worked less over the years, but the teams that play, you know, 2 days versus the team that play 1 day, the team that play 1 day definitely has some sort of advantage. That used to be at least 2 points, and now, I don't know, sometimes it's not even worth anything. Again, this is kind of like more feel now, but I'm aware of that. I used to love betting the superior coach in the first round game for very similar reasons that I talked about in some of those pre-conference neutral court tournaments that they played around Christmas time and Thanksgiving time, especially in the first round game where they have a few days to prepare and you know, the good coach can maybe come up with some creative game plan to win. You like betting on underachieving teams who have a new lease on life and maybe will get back to the level that they're more accustomed to playing to. Similarly, overachieving teams crash sometimes in these conference tournaments. You've seen it over the years, even in these one-bid leagues, like a team like Butler years ago. I'll never forget this. They played Wisconsin Green Bay in the first round, and they had murdered them both times during the year. And they were very clearly, you know, one of the best teams in the country, and they lost to Green Bay in the first round because the game meant like nothing to them. You know, it's just, how can we get up for this team? We've already beaten them by 30 twice. We have this great record. We have this great RPI. And, of course, the committee did not take them. So that put a damper on some of the one-bid leagues where you might expect a team to have a little problem. They learned very quickly that they still have to win their conference tournament, even if they think they're in. So you're just aware of, you know, how much energy does a team have left for a game, and do they really need this game to get in the tournament? And you can usually figure it out by that. And all this is kind of obvious, but I think obvious works more in conference tournaments than not. And you still find some sneaky things, but it's feel. It really is. It's just, you know, is this team really going to be ready, or can they put together another big effort? Or, you know, you've seen teams go 4 games in 4 days, and you've seen teams play great one day and just get murdered the next. And there's no set rules for that, but, you know, understanding how strong a team is and are they capable of carrying off back-to-back home run games. And again, that's all feel. So, you know, if a team's beaten them twice during the year, I think it is kind of hard to beat them a third time. It's not etched in stone. It's not 100%. But if you're, you know, like a Vanderbilt, Kentucky, let's say, if Kentucky happened to beat Vanderbilt twice during the year, and now they met in the conference tournament, I'd certainly wouldn't be afraid to bet a team like Vanderbilt to take the third game. You know, some real strong team that can play and would be capable of reversing things.
Sure. And when you say like take the third game, will you, as a bettor, consider money lines in those situations?
No, but it might be something to look at. I think money lines are sometimes the prices are kind of like it's not like a 10-cent line either way. It's like 20, 50, and
sure,
30, 70. You get cheated too often. I did make a good bet today. I took 110-1 on Nick Kyrgios to win the French Open. I will say that's something that people could look for, because Djokovic got hurt today. I don't know how bad his injury was, but he withdrew today, and Kyrgios is just running roughshod over everybody. He's beating everybody in straight sets and beating everybody very handily. He's always had top 10 talent, and yeah, clay's not his best surface, but he's not 110-1 to win that tournament. That's for goddamn sure. So that's my tennis tip. I don't have very good advice for college basketball, but that's my tennis tip. But yeah, I mean, if you just have in the back of your mind, because the thing is, the odds makers gotten better. They put a lot of these, you know, does the team need it in the price? And now it's just, it's almost all instinct. It really is. There's certain things that you don't really want to fight. I mean, you definitely would prefer to bet the team playing fresher. You definitely want the good coach versus the bad coach. You want to see, is a team playing with six guys, for a third game in a row versus a team that's used 10 guys. You know, so how much energy are they going to have? I wrote down that losing twice to a team does not necessarily work. So if a team's struggling coming into a tournament, team's playing poorly, I that's something different. Forget about that. There's something I wrote down, even from carrying over from the end of conference tournament to the NIT. There's certain teams that play these late conference tournament games. They now have an early week NIT game, and they just played four games in 4 days, and now they have to go out on the road in the NIT. That's a good thing to look forward to. They get blasted a lot. So that's one thing I wrote down to look for this year that I always forget.
Okay.
But each, you know, the conference tournament's a new lease on life, and then the NCAA tournament's a new lease on life. The NCAA tournament is again different because it's everyone's all in. It's not conference tournament where, you know, one team might not give a fuck and the other team might, and now you really got something good. The idea is figuring out who that's going to be, and that's maybe reading, that's maybe watching the teams play, that's maybe understanding what their psyche is coming into the conference tournament. You know, does a coach have some history of not caring about conference tournaments? This is all stuff that doesn't matter that much, but in combination, you can come up with some sort of gut as to who's going to win the game. And although I do power rate all the teams, I think it's less important conference tournament week, where during the season it's everything.
Okay.
Because it's so situational.
Okay. So as far as March Madness goes, or this time of year goes, specifically this year, what teams, if you have any, are you looking forward to watching the most in the next month? And if there might be some overlap with this next question, but what teams do you maybe anticipate maybe getting screwed over by the committee in the event that they do not win their conference tourney?
Well, the biggest potential for a fuck job is Valparaiso, who I have like the 12th or 13th best team in the country. Like I had a friend look for a price on Valpo to win the NCAA tournament. They didn't post it in Vegas anywhere. And you know, that would have been a great bet. I watched that team play Oakland on national TV, and they were just borderline perfect on both sides of the ball. And they have enough beef up front where when the refs let things go and they let these physically superior teams, you know, shove people out of the way and get rebounds and don't call fouls because, you know, you got to get the money in the right places. Again, I believe this from the bottom of my heart. I'm not trying to be some, nut job here. I totally believe that subconsciously the refs make some bad calls. I don't think they do it intentionally. I think subconsciously they're aware of what should happen or what needs to happen, and sometimes it just happened to happen that way. I mean, it's no coincidence that Duke has gotten every block charge go their way for 10 years that I've watched. I can't watch their games, but when I have watched it, they're that SMU block charge from years ago was maybe the worst call ever in a basketball game. And then the key block charge the following game when they beat Butler for the championship, of course, went Duke's way. So you typically see the same teams get good draws. Syracuse would be one. Duke would be one. The power schools that have been traditional power schools, so Kansas will usually get a fair shake. Kentucky doesn't always get a fair shake, which is kind of strange. Louisville would typically get a fair draw, although not anymore, because they're not in the tournament. They would have been a threat to win the whole thing this year too. You can talk about that for a second. I mean, what are they doing? They're admitting guilt by. It just shows you what's wrong with the sport, where this school says, okay, we're not playing the postseason this year, even though the kids there had absolutely nothing to do with it. They have 2 fifth-year graduate transfers who hadn't been to the school prior to this year, and they say, fuck you, you're not playing an NCAA tournament. Because by self-imposing a ban on them, they can limit the damage control later on, maybe.
Yes,
they're trying to protect their program for 10 years from now, which is just disgusting. It just, they don't give two fucks about the kids. It's just all so hypocritical. It's just so hard to deal with. But so who gets screwed? So West Virginia every year gets screwed. SMU, if they had a chance to be in it, would get screwed. I'm sure Virginia won't have any pleasant draw. Pittsburgh never gets a good draw. Gonzaga won't have a good draw. All your mid-majors will be playing either someone with intelligence or each other. And they'll misseed things to create those matchups. Last year, the most egregious fucking was of Stephen Austin. Somehow Utah ended up as a 5 seed, even though they're in the top 10 the entire year. They finished a little shakily, but they still were one of the strong teams in the tournament. Certainly not anywhere near a 5 seed. There weren't 16 teams better than them, even if they were the number 1 5 seed. You know, there weren't 10 teams better than them. But they had to find a team that plays with intelligence that could stop Stephen Austin, because Stephen Austin is extremely well coached and had a very, very strong team last year. And for some reason, the committee wanted them out. For some reason, the committee wants all these mid-majors out. And I've never understood that, because the highest-rated game on ESPN was Princeton-Duke, of years ago, when the Princeton player ended up in the third row with a bloody nose and they didn't call a foul on Georgetown. It was the 1-16. It stopped. They were gonna take away the automatic bid from the Ivy League, and after that game, they couldn't do it. Well, because the game was such a great game, it went to the wire. It was Pete Carrillo against John Thompson. It was this legendary game that Georgetown was like a 20-point favorite, and it went right to the wire. How can you take the automatic bid away from a team that plays the best team in the country that tough? So they didn't. So they came up with these ridiculous play-in games, which, by the way, should be illegal. It's 64 teams, that's it. It's the only tournament in the world where some teams have to win extra games to win. There's no other tournament anywhere where that's the case. Everyone else has equal, even the baseball, sometimes you have to play extra games because they're 2 out of 3 and they go 3 games, but everyone has 2 out of 3. It's not, no one has to win an extra round of games to get in there like they do in the NCAA tournament. It's just a complete greed fest. It's just, let's make sure Syracuse and all the good old boys, Kansas and Duke and North Carolina, let's make sure they have a good chance to get their money. We'll let them play close to home. We'll change that rule. It never used to be where you could play anywhere close to home, but they changed that rule. They change all the rules to take away intelligence, take as much intelligence out of the game as they can. And then when you see the draw, and it's been going on for years now, a team like Butler has never gotten a good draw. Even the fact that they've made it so far has been amazing, because they've gotten these ridiculous draws every year.
Were you expecting them to tail off at all when Brad Stevens left?
Yes and no, only because Brad Stevens is so brilliant, but no, because they're recruiting a little better player, and the coaches prior to Brad Stevens were all brilliant also, starting with Barry Collier, Thad Mata, et cetera, et cetera. Every Butler coach has been a genius. I mean, Brad Stevens was the best of the lot. But he really just took Barry Collier and made it a little bit better. So you know, given the pedigree of the coaches at Butler, I did not expect a big drop off because the coach figures to be fantastic. I went to a Butler Providence game, actually. I was invited to the Providence Butler game, which I went to, and Butler doesn't defend as well as they once did. They don't defend as well as they did under Stevens, so they're still fun to watch. Don't get me wrong. I love their two top players there, Roosevelt Jones and the white kid with the quick release, who's tough as nails. I love that kid. I forget his name. Dunham. Kellen Dunham?
Yep.
Yeah, he's great too. So it's just that I don't remember players anymore. But Butler's got a good team. But, you know, they get Butler players. They don't get Duke players. They don't get Kansas players. They don't get Kentucky players. It's just the talent gap is so big. It's just the talent gap is big, and now with a 30-second clock and the rule and the following changes, it makes it harder for the underdog to win. There's too many more possessions where extra shots on rebounds that the more athletic team gets breaks the back of the underdog more readily, and it sucks. It's sad. It's not supposed to be, let's get the money to the right places. It's not supposed to be the best team win. It's supposed to be, let kids go play basketball and let's try to actually even it out as best we can. Let's make it a fair tournament. Let's make it a great tournament. They don't want to do that at all. And they put it under the heading of, well, fans like high-scoring games. This fan doesn't. This fan likes watching good basketball. So,
yeah, high score.
You know, I like fast if it's good, like Virginia Commonwealth, you know, when Shaka Smart was there and the kid, the guy before him who ended up failing in Alabama. Fast can be good, but watching a set play work where they run a double screen and a guy comes underneath it and then a guy picks off the one guy who can still get him and he's wide open in a corner and they reverse it right around there and bang, he hits a three-pointer. It's beautiful to watch that. The timing of that could be incredible. And, It just, there's no point in doing that anymore. Just give it to your guard and tell him to go break the guy down. It's really a shitty game. So I'm not really answering your questions. I'm going on my hot rage, you know.
But basically,
you'll see every mid-major get fucked over. And any good team that plays with intelligence, a la Virginia, a la Wichita State, who gets screwed every year, they get the most brutal fucking draws every year. That year they were the one seed where they stuck Kentucky as an 8 seed in their bracket. It was just ridiculous. And Louisville was in their bracket, who should have been a 1 seed. And they were like a 4 seed. And God bless Charles Barkley, because he went on there and said, well, the only reason that Wichita section is so stacked is because they want them out. And then you get Jay Shillis on there saying that they don't belong as a 1 seed. You know, he's just a fucking shill for the big name schools. He makes his $250,000 a year and puts no effort into his job. It's really kind of sad. And they got Fraudinati there predicting all the wrong teams, but he gets them right. Because the committee doesn't get all the right teams in there. They just get a bunch of Big 12 teams that don't deserve it, although this year most of them will. Typically they don't. They'll screw some mid-majors who they don't know are any good. They just don't know who's good. Yeah, meanwhile, they got a guy, whatchamacallit, that guy, that Ken Palm, he does good ratings, so they actually have someone who's respected outside of asking a gamble, which they never would do. That would be the smart thing to do. You know, can you send us your power ratings and help us put together a fair tournament? That would be a smart thing to do. Instead, they have all these asinine RPIs and strength of schedules and all this other bullshit that means absolutely nothing. Doesn't tell you who the better team is. So they get it all misseeded. But it's so ambiguous that they're allowed to do whatever the hell they want. And then, you know, when they leave a team out, even though the team fit all the parameters that they wanted, they'll come up with some other fucking bullshit reason to leave them out. It's just corrupted. It's terrible. So that's what's going to happen. You'll see Virginia get some brutal draw, and Wichita will get some brutal draw, or, you know, and Stephen Austin, they'll get screwed like they always do, and South Dakota State will get screwed. You'll see.
So as far as I think you mentioned this earlier, there where you haven't really been paying attention to the, you know, the Fraudinati bracketology bullshit.
No, not at all. It gets me sick.
So do you – are there
– I actually know who the good teams are. I actually can rate them and rate them properly. They can't. They can give you all these reasons that mean nothing and be right because the committee gets all the wrong teams right. You know, that they get all the wrong teams right. That's the easiest way to say it. But it's all self-perpetuating. If they got Fraudinati out there saying, well, so-and-so's in, so-and-so's in, so-and-so's in, and he's right every year, they can use him as proof that they're doing the right things with their selections. Well, Fraudinati got it right. And what other frauds they have as bracketologists got it right. But that doesn't mean it is right. Because they got it right for all the wrong reasons. So they got the wrong teams in. It is what it is, you know. It's big business.
So are there any teams that you're paying attention to right now that aren't really doing that well that you anticipate getting a boost from the mainstream media or Fraudinati, Billis, all them?
No idea. I have no idea what they – I have no idea what – I don't know one word they say, and I can't even stomach hearing him talk. I really can't. I get mad. I used to have these tirades on Twitter, which I haven't done lately, but I just don't think people give two fucks about what I tweet anymore, and I quite frankly don't blame them. I wouldn't want to read my shit either right now. But
I feel the same way about my tweets, so yeah.
I'll put some thought out there, you know, during conference center weeks, I'll put some thought out there, and hopefully it'll do a little better. But it's not that I don't want to. It's just that when I tweet a loser, it's just so hard on me that it's just not worth it. But there's nothing going to change this year except the rules made it harder on mid-majors and lesser teams, and that's what they want. And that's the theme that I'm going to give you the whole way through here. That doesn't mean there won't be maybe a good bet here and there in the NCAA tournament, but I think that the South Dakota States of the world and the – well, maybe not Valparaiso because they're so good it might not matter, but maybe like an Akron – some of these other mid-majors that are pretty strong ratings are going to have a hard time because the extra shove when they get shoved out of the way and don't get the rebound is not going to go their way. When the seedings come out, it's not going to go their way. They're going to get some bad matchup or they're going to get matched up with a team that does what they do a little better, and then the committee will take out that team later. So you see Virginia play a South Dakota State because South Dakota State could beat a team like Kansas. They could beat a team like Kentucky. You know, smart can still beat athletic, even though there's only 30 seconds to control now instead of 35. Even though the game has been lengthened, which doesn't help them, it's still possible to have that upset. So they've completely taken that out of the equation with all these rigged draws that they've had over the years where they match up mid-major or mid-major versus smart team. And that's what I predict will happen because that's what happened in the last 3 years. And they've gotten more and more egregious with their cheating is what I call it. They spend 3 days on how to make sure the money gets to the right places and not anything else but. So to me, the draw is almost entirely rigged and it's sad because it has the potential to be such a great event.
All right, well, we'll move on. I know we're crunched on time. You got your American Idol, so there's a few listener questions that I wanted to get to.
Sorry, I got too long. You should just cut me off. And
no,
tell me
no,
fuck,
I
know?
Can't. No,
I'm really not helping you at all with picks here. I don't have much to say about it, though. I really don't. It's really just you got to wing it.
No.
Near the end of the year, you just got to wing it. Read and wing it. Yeah, watch games and wing it.
No, yeah.
Fan, wing it. You know, the line comes out, Kentucky 7, that's too high. They don't give a fuck about this game. They're in. They don't care. The coach wants to rest his young kids. They've been beaten, you know, put through the ringer. And that's it. You take the 7 and you win, if you're right. And that's more, I think, how you have to do it, rather than trying to create some power rating, especially conference tournament week.
All right. Yeah, no, and by the way, this podcast has never really been about picks. I never ask anybody for picks, so you know you're never put on the spot to do that. So one of the listener questions was he wanted your thoughts on two coaches, Calvin Sampson and Craig Neal as coaches.
You know, Sampson, I think Sampson's pretty good. He's certainly done a good job with Houston. He's good for the modern basketball. He likes playing an open game. Defensively, his teams have been a little shaky over the years, and that usually hurts come tournament time. But he's done a hell of a job at Houston, and you know, I whatever sleazy thing he did, I'm sure he's still doing it, and I'm sure he'll use the Houston job to get more in the limelight again, and that's kind of shitty, but that's probably what's going to happen. So I think he's good, not great. I think offensively he does good things. I think defensively his teams are a little could do better, and even offensively I think his teams are take a lot of bad shots. But in the modern world where kids don't like to be restricted, it's not necessarily a bad thing. So, you know, Kelvin Sampson is probably like a 6 on a 10 scale.
All right.
Neil, I think he's been a little disappointing, but it was hard to gauge him because his team got so beat up last year. He lost all his good players. When I watched them the first year that Alford left, I wasn't impressed. I think he's a notch below Alford as a coach. So again, he's kind of like a 6 out of a 10. His team has done well this year, and they're certainly a threat to win that Mountain West tournament. They got a very good team, and you know, they're only like a half a point to a point worse than San Diego State. So it wouldn't surprise me. They got a good following in Vegas. They could win the conference tournament. Vegas could win the conference tournament. They got a shitload of talent. But you talk about a team that ain't got a clue. My God. Big surprise Dave Rice didn't last a year. This one I got right, by the way. I said he was the worst Division I coach that I ever watched, and I think Roy Williams took that over during that Duke game. He may have taken over as the all-time biggest idiot, but Dave Rice was right up there. Anyway, so Neil was like a 6 out of a 10 also. I think his teams do a lot of good, but I don't think they're as precise in their actions as they once were with Alford. Did I lose you? Fuck.
All right, I had my microphone on mute, and I just realized it now. I was gonna say the segue was perfect when you mentioned Dave Rice, because the next question was from actually somebody that's based in Las Vegas, and he was asking if UNLV broke any kind of unwritten rule by firing him mid-season, because I guess that's not a common thing. And then he
asked, I agree. I would not have fired the guy. I would have given him a chance to finish the year. I mean, you know, nothing happened this year that wasn't expected. I mean, Dave Rice has always been a guy who's gotten good players to come there and taught them absolutely nothing about basketball. Just watching them play in a tournament, they've embarrassed themselves every year in the tournament under this guy. So they knew what they had, and nothing changed, and then they fired him. I would have let him finish the year out for sure.
Okay.
I do think Patino, if they don't bar him from the sport, will probably get that job, and it's perfect because prostitution's legal in Vegas, right?
That was actually the guy's next question, who they should go after for their next head coach.
I think Rod Barnes would be a great choice. I think Reggie Theus would be a great choice. I know they all want that other kid who played at UNLV who's worked there. I forget his name, but he was one of our Tarkanian's boys who's stuck with the program, who the kids would respect. But I thought years ago when the guy from Florida Atlantic, Green, is that his name? No, not Green. Fuck. He was a UNLV guy too. Anyway, you know, some of their former players might do a good job, but I think Rod Barnes would be a good choice. He's at Cal State Bakersfield. He was coach of the year at Mississippi. He did eventually get fired from Mississippi, but, you know, he got the expectations a little too high there when they made the tournament a couple times. It's more of a football school than a basketball school, and the basketball programs haven't been that great, but he's doing a hell of a job at Bakersfield. He's squeaky clean. He probably fits their budget. He can recruit because he's been in big-time athletics before, and he's a really good coach. Unfortunately, he's more of a defensive-type coach, but I think he would adapt. I think he would get the more open game that the UNLV fans like, and I think he'd be a good choice.
Okay.
But he's definitely outside the box.
Okay. And another question he had, and I wasn't aware of this story before when you were – this must have been when you were in Vegas, but he was asking about the time you got mugged and at leaving a sports book. I don't know if you care to get into that or
I know nothing. To this day, I don't know why that happened. I'm turning my screen on for a second here because I have to do something.
No problem.
Hopefully the freaking game hasn't started yet. I forgot about it. Where is this game? Oh, there it is. Oh, it goes at 8:30. Okay. I'll get this off. Oh, Drexel's going to win.
Bet going in your favor there, I assume?
Yeah, that's a small bet that's going to win in Western Carolina. I'll look at these fucking scores later here. You know, typically, street protocol, the person before there were two people supposedly, a lady saw it, and they cracked me with some metal thing. Normally, they would say, this is from so-and-so. You know, so-and-so says hello or whatever, and then they'd whack me. But that didn't happen. They just came from behind and got me, and they didn't take the money I had in my pocket. I had $5,000 in my pocket. To this day, I don't know how or why that happened. I've never screwed anybody out of money, not in my life. I never deceived anybody out there. I never fucked anyone's wife. I never did anything that would be deserving of getting shellacked like that. And if, in fact, the guy at the trauma center and my physical therapist said, if I wasn't so strong, I was in really good shape at the time. I was an animal back then. My core was so strong that it absorbed the blow enough where I didn't become a vegetable. So I just had a concussion and a separated shoulder, and that was it.
Damn.
And the following week was kind of cool. It was like we filled up the Riviera Racing Sportsbook, and that was like almost impossible to do. And I got a standing ovation for showing up to, you know, I told the people, you know, I'm taking the same route, and if you want to try to get me again, come and get me, you know. But
yeah, when did that happen?
We're doing a Beat Boston contest at the Riviera, and about week 4 or 5, it happened. The only thing I came up with is I was wearing my Full Tilt hoodie, and I was wearing my Full Tilt beanie because I was representing Full Tilt Poker. And the only thing I came up with is maybe, you know, some mob thought I was coming into their territory, and they were, you know, saying no. I couldn't come up with any other reason.
Okay.
Hammer out front, and that's just not my style. So
okay, and I know you have to get going soon. So one last question was for those who might still have odds on people who could bet on winning the American Idol. You're a big American Idol fan. Who do you have winning American Idol?
The favorite, I think, is going to be hard to beat. That Dalton Rapatoni kid. He seems to be well-liked. He's very musical. It's a short season. I don't think his act will grow tired. He's very, very creative. He puts on a good show. He's got a lot of experience. I think he'll get the female vote, too. I think he's kind of a pretty boy, even though I think he looks kind of weird. But and the other kid is Mackenzie Borg. Neither one of them have the strongest voices, but they're both very musical and very creative, and I'm hoping that one of those two win.
Okay.
LaPorsche is the best of the girls, but she's very old school, and she needs to modernize herself to have a chance, I think. But I'm not very good at predicting these things either, so.
All right. Well,
but those are my two favorites, are those two kids. They're Dalton and Mackenzie, who are very similar, and they twist songs and make them their own and sing them well.
All right. Well, I know we're approaching the end here. I know you're probably looking to watch that. Are you looking to get going right now?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I'll let you go, Alan, but I appreciate you joining the pod and giving your insight and
Yeah, sorry I didn't do better. I really am. I didn't feel well, and I didn't really answer the questions that well, so sorry.
No, I think
hope they enjoy it.
I enjoyed it, and every pod that you've had that I've had you on, I've always gotten a lot of people to comment that they appreciate my pods with you more than being on ESPN pods where you're censored. So we always.
Yeah, I've been asked on there all year, so that's a little disappointing.
So. Well, I'm glad that you came on, and you know, if we could squeeze one in before the end of the season, I'd like that. But
that's fine. Just send on Skype or email me.
Sounds good, Alan. Well, thanks for joining, everyone. Thanks
for having me.
And have a good night, everyone.
Cheers.
All right, good night, Alan.
Good night. Thank you. Yep.